Hello and welcome in to Stick to Sports. I'm Luke Owens.
And I'm Matt Watling. We've got a great show for you tonight talking Sam Darnold's return, Monomania, one struggling championship caliber team, and game three of the ALCS.
Roll it.
We've got a jam-packed show for you tonight, and well, let's start with boy bands. Everybody loves them, of course, right? Well, the Seahawks receiving corps certainly does, and their celebration of a first-half touchdown was the best thing we saw this week. And just, oh, beautiful.
Yeah,
oh,
I know.
It's beautiful. Oh, bye, bye.
Can you give me the lyrics right now?
I see we can't.
I was really
copyright.
Hoping you were going to sing on live TV.
It's
no,
copyright.
I was hoping you,
well, you
were
know
going to sing,
sing
for me on live TV.
No, I don't sing, first of all.
Rumor
second,
is,
I can do the dance, I'm not going to sing it.
Word on the street is that you can sing, you just choose not to.
It's a mix of both, yes and no.
Yeah.
I can sing if I really wanted to, but I don't.
I was hoping you would. Maybe I'll get you to do it next week.
Probably
and
not.
Moving into our segments, it took five games for the Washington Nationals to defeat the Dodgers in the NLDS, but it may take less than that to punch your ticket to the World Series. After an 8-1 win last night, the Nats now lead the NLCS 3-0, and they lead game four currently 7-5 in the bottom of the seventh. Matt, you said, you actually tweeted the Nationals were the team of destiny. Is this still the case?
That I did, and first off, the disrespect that you didn't like it, first of all.
No one
absolutely
liked it.
The fact that no one liked it is astonishing.
Look at this.
And
no likes, no retweets.
What is this? Why is it on night mode?
October 2nd, I only use night mode. You know this. I'm not a psychopath.
Excuse me?
But let me tell you, Matt, you tweeted on October 2nd, and now we're sitting here. The Nats are two innings away from the World Series. Are they this team of destiny that we talked about?
You know, first off, follow me at MattWalling99. You can see it right there. Clearly, I need the help. But in reality, why not for this team? They've got four dangerous starting pitchers if you add in Patrick Corbin, who's been more of a relief role. And that kind of mitigates that bullpen issue that we talk about. And for me, there's no pressure. They remind me a lot of the Washington Capitals, where they were a team that they finally got the monkey off their back in terms of pressure. They got off the schneid beating the Penguins, and then you saw them roll right after that. The Washington Nationals getting their first playoff win with the wild card, potentially winning this now, that could really help.
Yeah, and going on five-game win streaks, they'll try to carry that win streak into tonight and possibly the World Series as well. That starting pitching, like you said, is deadly.
Yeah, and starting with streaks, the Jets started their own streak in Sam Darnold's first game back. The Jets quarterback led his team to a 24-22 victory. He completed 23 of 32 passes, throwing for two touchdowns and an interception. The Jets now sit at 1-4 and looked pretty darn good, Luke.
They did look pretty darn good, and I'm glad Sam Darnold is back. It kind of lets us really sit back and evaluate this team. And what I really love here is Robbie Anderson going on that deep ball. Then you've got Jameson Crowder for those checkdowns. You got Demaryius Thomas kind of on those in-between routes. And I really like the pieces this offense has going forward.
Yeah, and to me, everyone's calling for Gase's head after week one. And it didn't make sense to me. I'm sitting here, he's playing with David Falk.
Exactly.
Not a good quarterback, clearly. The defense didn't look great, and they couldn't move the ball. They had maybe five first downs in terms of leading up to that game against the Eagles. And to me, I really love that long bomb, that 92-yard pass to Robbie Anderson that you saw. And that's what I was looking for out of Sam Darnold. You know, take a shot for Adam Gase, show some guts and throw for a deep play, and they did just that.
Yeah, and what even makes this more scary is that Le'Veon Bell only had 53 total yards last game. So if you can really get him going in a defense that was able to contain Dak Prescott last weekend, that could be something going forward.
Yeah, and that schedule's pretty easy, so don't look now. But I'm not saying they're going to be a wild card team, but maybe, just maybe.
All right, relax.
Maybe.
Relax a
maybe.
Little bit.
Maybe, I'm just saying.
And the Los Angeles Rams steamrolled the NFC last season to the tune of a 13-3 record before being stopped by the Patriots in the Super Bowl. But after a 20-7 loss to the division rival 49ers, LA is now 3-3 this year, matching their loss total from last season. In division with the 49ers, the Red Hot Seahawks, is it panic time for the Rams?
You know, I think it is. I really do. And you look at this team and you add Jalen Ramsey, you trade away Marcus Peters, Aqib Talib, your other cornerback goes on IR. But this offense is not the same as last year. It's not the same. There's something different in the water. They've kind of figured out what Sean McVay does as a great head coach.
I think what it's been figured out that quarterback Jared Goff is a product of Sean McVay's amazing system, and now he can't really hide behind that when Todd Gurley's not kind of playing up to snuff. And this defense has allowed 105 points the last three games. That's not good. You can't allow 55 points to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and expect to be good, excuse me. And with the 49ers and Seahawks in that division, I really think it's full-on panic mode for the Rams.
Yeah, for the offense, their rushing yards is 22nd in the NFL with 98.3, which seems like a lot. But yeah, for Todd Gurley, he's not the same player as he once was.
Injured.
And for Jared Goff, 7 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. So they're not even really hiding him. He's making mistakes. It's not like he's a Marcus Mariota where he doesn't look great, but he's not making mistakes. He's actively making mistakes, and that's a huge problem.
Yeah, and I think numbers-wise, they're not the worst team in the world. They're kind of middle of the pack, but they just don't pass that eye test on offense anymore. They're just not as special as they were last season.
Yeah, when you have Seattle at 5-1 and the Niners at 5-0, they look really, really scary good. But now moving to other scary good-looking teams, the NHL season has been underway for about 2 weeks now. And there's been some surprising teams at the top of the standings to start this week. Several teams that failed to make the playoffs were undefeated, including the Buffalo Sabres, Luke. Your guys, what have you seen from them?
Well, they've been great on the power play, 42.9%. That's first in the NHL. Jack Eichel, of course, has been outstanding. But Victor Olofsson, they call him Golofsson around Buffalo, 5 goals, 2 assists on the year for the rookie.
All on the power play, those
guys. Yeah, and it has been all on the power play, which kind of skews those numbers. But they've looked a lot better than they did last year.
And to me, the biggest issue was they had a 10-game winning streak last year, right? They couldn't continue it. They have a new coach now coming over from, I believe, Sweden.
Right.
I believe he coached Austin Matthews.
Also was in the EPL for a little while, Ralph Kruger.
Yep, so you look at him. Does he have that better strategy? Do you think he's a coach that can kind of have this sustain?
I don't know if it's a strategy. I think it's the locker room. The environment that he kind of brings and the culture is really what they like. But what teams have you seen that you've liked this season
so far?
You know,
one team that's interested me, I don't want to say I like them, but the Anaheim Ducks have been really interesting. Last year, they were brutal. They had injuries. They weren't really good. And to me, this year, that agent core hasn't made an impact. You know, Ryan Getzlaf, 2 points in 3 games. And for me, they've had unreal goaltending kind of inflate their record.
And Wednesday night, the Sabres travel to Anaheim, so we'll have to keep our eyes on that. Yep. But we'll be right back here on Stick to Sports.
When we come back, we'll break down the NFC East, or should I say, the NFC Least.
Welcome back to Stick to Sports. Before we get to the NFC East, let's dive into the ALCS. In this week's Big Talk, the Yankees led the Astros 1-0 in the ALCS after a big Game 1 road win. But after running into Justin Verlander and Gerrit Cole, the Bombers now trail the series 2-1. The Astros, of course, have some of the best starting pitching in the game, where the Yankees pride themselves, of course, on their bullpen. But is the Yankees' lack of dominant starting pitching an issue in this series?
You know, you almost think it is at this point, because when you saw what happened in Game 2 especially, I thought that's kind of what describes the need for starting pitching to a T, is you see Paxton go, 2 1/3 innings, you pull in your bullpen, and now it goes to 11 innings. So you have Luis Sessa and Jay Happ as your last two guys in extras, whereas for the Astros, you get Verlander to go 7 innings. And then from there, you have your full bullpen.
Yeah, and look who's been winning in the playoffs this year. It's been the Nationals and the Astros, who have leaps and bounds the best rotations in the game.
And shaky bullpen.
Yeah, and the Yankees got down 2-0 early in this one, and it just seems like an upward battle. You give Gerrit Cole or Justin Verlander one run, and that they're just going to run with it.
So, Luke, with that, do you think this needing a good bullpen is a bit overhyped? Do you think that's not as necessary?
I think it's still as necessary, but you also need to have those starting pitchers. With the Yankees kind of having Tanaka and Paxton, but it's just so iffy. You know what you're getting out of Cole and Verlander, but this Yankees offense has not helped them out.
No, not at all. And you look at these issues, but also you say, look who they face. You know, Justin Verlander, you got 5 hits off him. Yeah, you only scored 2 runs in 11 innings, but that's impressive. My issue there is they're not producing against the bullpen of the Astros. You see guys like Brett Gardner and Encarnacion, they were brutal. I think between those two and you add in a guy like Sanchez, they were 0 for 25 or 24, I want to say, which was really, really, or 2 for 25, I should say, which is just bad. You can't be like that.
It's been bad. It's kind of been first pitch swinging for Gardner and Edwin Encarnacion, and I just don't understand the logic in putting Gardner in the 3-hole at this point. I think that's where Gleyber Torres looked comfortable in Game 2, and they move Brett Gardner there, and you're kind of scratching your head.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense. Bat him 9. You know, he's got speed. He's not hitting right now. So if you bat him 9, if he gets on base, you're kind of using him like a leadoff.
You're right.
And he can kind of use some of that weaponry. But for me, this team was built off a scary 1-9 lineup, and when you don't have that, when you have 3 guys that are struggling, that makes this team a lot more beatable.
Yeah, in Game 4, there actually could be a rainout. So that's something to keep an eye on, because if this game gets moved back a day into Thursday, which team does it benefit more? Does it benefit the Yankees with a fully rested Tanaka or the Astros with Zach Greinke?
I think it helps the Yankees in the sense that you're getting Tanaka. You don't have to rely on your bullpen, which you've had to rely on for a bunch of innings in the last 2 games. And for the Yankees, Tanaka's that guy that can kind of be the stalwart, the guy that stops the losing streak. Hopefully he gets a win for you if you're a Yankees fan.
Yeah.
And then you get some momentum going into Game 5 at home and then 6 and 7 on the road.
You almost pray for a rainout if you're the Yankees. You let your bullpen rest up. You know, Severino went 4, which was okay, but you want to keep that bullpen rested.
Do a little rain dance for us.
Get Tanaka on tonight. Full rest for sure.
And now moving to football now, the NFC East has earned its infamous NFC Least nickname this season, as no team is above 500. The Eagles and Cowboys both sit at 3-3. The Giants a game back at 2-4. And the Redskins are just 1-5. Now, looking at the Cowboys, they followed up their 3-0 start with three straight losses. So, Luke, what can you make of this team?
It's really tough, but the Cowboys, they just have not beaten a good team this year. And they lost to the Saints and the Packers, who are kind of up there with the NFC best.
And the elite Jets. And
the elite Jets. To me, this is a 9-7 team, and I don't know if that gets them a second wild card, if it leaves them a game out, but this just screams 9-7 to me.
Yeah, I agree. I think they're the team that they've always been under Dak Prescott. A good regular season team. They just can't make noise in the playoffs. I mean, to me,
their weapons are so good.
They are good. So I wonder if it's coaching. Because you can win with a game manager. If Mark Sanchez can win, go to the AFC Championship game, Dak Prescott surely can.
Yeah, he definitely can. Like I said, all those pieces. But good news for them is this NFC East is just really wide open. And obviously, the Cowboys go to the Eagles this weekend. They've got to come away with a win there, and you've got to get Ezekiel Elliott going full. I mean, he had over 100 yards against the Jets, but he wasn't really dominant as he has been.
And you speak about those lowly teams, the Redskins and Giants. The Redskins are so bad.
Yeah.
There's nothing else you can say about them. To me, they're last year Arizona Cardinals.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't know if you have a quarterback. You really don't have much weapons. You know, Darius Geis, I guess.
Yeah.
You don't have anything there. And for me, their infrastructure's garbage. Between Dan Snyder and Bruce Allen, their GM.
Yeah, and they also go up against the 49ers, the Vikings, and the Bills the next 3 weeks. At least with the Giants, you kind of had the pieces. You like what you've seen out of Jones so far. Obviously, some rookie moments, but you've got Sterling Shepard. You've got Barkley, you've got Ingram. You kind of see the pieces. With Washington, you're throwing out Colt McCoy. Like, you don't know what you have out of Haskins yet. But that's not really their fault, though. He just hasn't been ready yet. He hasn't really figured out the NFL system.
And with the Giants, you've got $90 million in cap space. And for me, the thing I would preach is don't make it a quick fix.
Right.
Don't throw money at aging defenders. Instead, build through the draft. Because you've got Daniel Jones. You've got young pieces with Saquon Barkley, too. So build it the right way. That's the one thing I'd have to say. And then you kind of look at the Eagles now, and I think they're my team that can make the most noise in the playoffs.
It's tough because right now I trust the Cowboys' defense a little bit more than the Eagles, but Carson Wentz is head and shoulders better than Dak Prescott when he's on. When he's on, he's MVP caliber.
Yeah, and for me, I like DeSean Jackson coming back. It's all about that secondary.
Yeah.
And can Doug Peterson, their head coach, do something? And he actually guaranteed a win against the Cowboys, too.
Right, and you mentioned Carson Wentz and getting DeSean Jackson back. DeSean Jackson really is, to me, that kind of lightning bolt, that extra energy that this Eagles offense needs. And Alshon Jeffrey, to me, is a great wide receiver one. And you don't really know what Nelson Aguilar is at this point. I mean, he's kind of just become a meme. But obviously, Ertz at tight end has become Wentz's favorite target.
Yeah, for sure. We're going to take a quick break here on Stick to Sports.
Don't go anywhere, because when we come back, Andy will take my place to run Matt through his weekly stories.
Welcome back to Sticks of Sports. Joining me now is Andy Guidi. Andy, there was a big series that wrapped up last Thursday, right?
That's right, Matt. The Washington Mystics defeated the Connecticut Sun Thursday to capture their first women in NBA title in franchise history. It was a hard-fought five-game series that saw neither team win back-to-back contests. Center Emma Meisterman won the finals MVP, averaging 18 points and 5 rebounds per game. The title also marks the first for two-time MVP Elena Delladon, who played for a broken nose and 3 herniated discs during the series. The team rallied around her toughness with a tough and gritty performance in the Game 5 clincher in front of a raucous D.C. home crowd. Jonquel Jones led the Connecticut Sun with 25 points and 5 rebounds in the loss.
And that's astonishing to me that Elena Delladon wins her first NBA or WNBA title in 7 years, but also through all those injuries. I mean, you talk about like hockey players playing tough and all this. This is incredible. Where you see some players, you know, you scratch yourself, you need load management in the NBA. I mean, she's playing through 3 herniated discs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. A lot of people don't watch the women NBA, and I don't know why. The women NBA breeds a lot of tough individual players, and Elena Delladon is a representation of that. She played through 3 injuries to win her first title. You know, she's been looking for it, for a very long time. She had a chance to win it in 2014 with the Chicago Sky, but got swept in an embarrassing series, and she got swept again last year, so she wasn't going to let anything defeat her this time.
Yeah, that's just absolutely incredible.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The Jalen Ramsey saga is finally over. This afternoon, the Jacksonville Jaguars traded the cornerback to the Los Angeles Rams for 3 future draft picks, including a first rounder in 2020. The 2-time Pro Bowler finally got his wish to leave the Sunshine State after requesting a trade back in September. He's headed to a Rams squad that has a hole at cornerback after an injury to Aqib Talib and is looking to win another NFC title and Super Bowl. We'll see if the trade pays off, as their next game is against the Falcons this Saturday.
Yeah, and to me, this is a really good trade for the Rams. Obviously, you're going all in here. And you're 3-3 as a team right now. And I wonder, is this the time to make the move? Because if it doesn't pay off, you might have a top 15 pick on your hands. And also, to me, I'll relate this to the NBA for you, Andy, and you say, it feels like the NFL is almost turning to the NBA, where you're getting players to use their own power and use leverage to say, I'm not playing for you guys anymore. I want to get traded. And what are your kind of thoughts on that?
Player empowerment is in full effect right now. All the superstars in both the NBA and NFL are fighting to get what they want. And the Rams have no choice. They need this trade to win for them because they haven't had a first-round draft pick since 2016, and they won't have another one until 2022. So they need it to work out, or they'll just be giving away a bunch of assets, you know, for nothing.
Yeah, and for the Jaguars, you're getting two firsts at it, which is a really impressive move for them.
Yeah, so you know, they're going all in. This is a risky trade. They're trying to get back to the Super Bowl, so we're gonna see what happens with that one. This situation just won't die down. Yesterday, while speaking to the media, Lakers superstar LeBron James shared his opinion on Daryl Morey's tweets about China from earlier this month.
You know, when you're misinformed or you're not educated about something, and I'm just talking about, you know, the tweet itself, you know, you never know the ramifications that can happen. You know, we all seen what that did.
And to me, this is just a shot. Another thing where this is just a mess, this whole situation with Daryl Morey in China. To me, it's just stop talking about it. The entire NBA, just stop talking, because it's like they're trying to put a grease fire out with water. You can't do that.
Yeah,
you gotta stifle the flames, cut the oxygen supply off, and just let it die. Because every time an NBA player or a coach even alludes or answers the question, yeah, you know, media has the right to ask these questions, but the players have the right to just not answer and say, look, he said it, he apologized for it, it's over. Because anytime they continue to do this, it just adds more problems to it.
Yeah, it continues to drag out. This situation keeps getting worse and worse. LeBron James and the Lakers, they're making themselves look bad by even commenting on the situation. I think they should just leave it alone, let Adam Silver and the commissioner do their thing. You know, this is very disappointing. This is not what the NBA is used to, you know?
Right, for sure. And Andy, thank you for joining me. Coming up after the break, we'll present you with our curtain call coming up next on WTOP 10.
Welcome back to Stick to Sports.
It's now time for our cheer and jeer of the week, and we'll give one cheer to Patrick Marleau. The 22-year veteran of the NHL has made his return to San Jose after 2 years with Toronto. While the aging star did not win a cup with the Maple Leafs, he still got a tremendous welcome by the San Jose faithful. And in fact, it brought him to tears in this clip.
I absolutely love this so much.
That's it.
Well, I didn't know if we were letting the tears.
And there's the tears a little bit. You see all that cut up.
What I love about this is he got to play for San Jose. He went home to Canada. He got to play for the Maple Leafs. And now he comes back. I mean, it's really the perfect career. And if he can somehow capture a cup with San Jose, I think it'd be the perfect ending.
It would be unbelievable. And for me, like, the San Jose Sharks, they're a fun team to watch. But Martin Jones, scary in net, man.
Yeah, and Vegas might have really ended them.
Oof, yeah.
And our jeer from this week comes from Los Angeles, where the LA Kings have not been playing good hockey for a few years now. However, their fans are attributing this to the Taylor Swift banner that hangs in the Staples Center, commemorating Swift's record for sold-out appearances, which first went up in 2015, the year after the Kings won their last Stanley Cup. The Kings will be covering the banner for the remainder of their home games. Matt, why did they have to take this out on my girl T-Swift?
It's absolutely unbelievable and frankly unacceptable that you're gonna just, come on. She knew you were trouble when you walked in. She sold out your crowd, your arena.
Shame on you now. Shame on you now. I'm just finishing your song
reference.
Shame
on you now. Let's think of some other ones. Come on.
I got a blank space, baby. Write my name
blank
on the
space,
cup.
Yep.
Yeah, you could write
That's
your name
good.
On the cup.
All right, and you know what? That there's nothing else we can say about that. We'll hit both our big things right now. All right, and 2 weeks ago, Thursday, Maven took control of SI from their publication company, Meredith, and in one obscene and foul motion, Maven shattered the good name of SI and changed the landscape of sports journalism. Maven fired half their editorial staff, looking to create hyper-local sports communities where fans contribute to websites under the name of SI. This can be compared to Fansided or SB Nation, and while sports is supposed to be fun, it's also a microcosm of society as a whole. In an era of fake news and distrust, sports media will surely lose trust because of Maven. While Sports Illustrated will, quote, continue its legacy, it will struggle. This was not a layoff due to profit. This was a purge. Sports Illustrated will still have tremendous credentialed writers who have access to teams, but it will not be the same. Maven will transform SI into content farms focused on SEO, not journalism. And that is only the second biggest tragedy. The people behind the story being the biggest, and so many amazing and talented people lost their jobs, just ripped from them for no good. On Twitter, the hashtag SaveSI went viral as those in the sports world pleaded with Sports Illustrated's owners, Authentic Brands Group, to reconsider their deal with Maven. And anyone can spew nonsense and throw words on a page. It takes true talent and training to craft a narrative. And these SI stories throughout the decades have made people cry. Reading them were just emotional roller coasters. And not only that, they can also inspire students like myself and Luke to share the story that goes beyond the box score. Fans cannot write real features on players. Their lack of access, their innate bias blinds them to the truth, and that's okay. That's what fans are for. However, this is not Sports Illustrated, at least not what it should be.
Well said, Matt. Well said. And now we're going to move into my one big thing. Earlier this week, Zach Greinke gave a press conference that lasted just 2 minutes ahead of Game 1 of the ALCS. Some players will give two-minute answers to questions, but if you're interviewing Greinke, you'll be lucky to get two words out of him. That's because Greinke has diagnosed social anxiety disorder. So before you go to Twitter to make fun of a guy, why don't you step back and look at the facts? All of the immediate reactions to the presser were making fun of the Astros right-hander, with a few even suggesting Greinke essentially thinks he's better than or too cool for the media. But this is a problem that dates all the way back to high school, where Greinke would rarely talk in class, even when called on. In 2006, Greinke was dealing with severe depression and anxiety each and every day he showed up for spring training with the Royals. Playing baseball was the only thing that kept Greinke going back to the ballpark. And after his diagnosis, Greinke was prescribed anti-anxiety medication to help cope. Now 12 years later, Greinke has become one of the most dominant pitchers of his era. So shame on accounts like SNY that immediately attacked Greinke for being short-winded. The fact he is even able to sit up there and answer questions is impressive. And this is nothing new. It's something Greinke has battled for years. And now October is Mental Health Awareness Month. So be mindful of those around you, and you never really can tell what's going on inside someone. And of course, if you have those feelings, seek help. Luckily, there are many resources available in this day and age. Let's all try to be courteous of one another and avoid jumping to unnecessary conclusions.
Right, and Luke, with Zach Greinke, he's someone that this affects him so much that there was reports that he would decline a trade to the Yankees earlier in this season, saying, you know, not that the big stage is too big for him, but the New York media, and it's scary to face.
Yeah, and you kind of have to think about that's such a big stage, and for a guy that deals with these anxiety disorders and that media market, just wouldn't it be good? So good on him to kind of think of his mental health. But kind of tracking back to SI, is this kind of something we could see in journalism where you talked about writing for the SEO and the clicks? That's just so sad to think about in sports journalism.
Yeah, and the thing that's even sadder is it happens in news as well and in general stories as well. You see people like BuzzFeed and SB Nation and Fansided, they do these things where they just pop off random stories that mean nothing.
And that's
there's
not
no real context to it. And for sports journalism, you want more than that.
Yeah.
You want it to go beyond just the random stuff and the random analysis. You want real heartwarming stories.
Definitely not the journalism I grew up reading, so definitely a sign.
Right. And that's all the time we have this week for Stick to Sports.
And tune in next week, same time, same place, right here on WTOP 10.